It's nationalistic, colonialist, racist, and it's based on a completely different part of the Old Testament. The father and the mother in the world of ethnic cleansing, Joshua, several chapters in Joshua, in the book Joshua. But still, the Zionists think, as you just heard, that they are innocent, as you can see from the next slide. They are innocent as babies. And the Palestinians started it because they came there on the basis of the manifest, provable lie, a people without country, without country into a country without people. Okay. That was their device at the moment, at that moment. Now we come to analyze Zionism, and because you may ask, why are there so many bad elements in Zionism? How did they enter into it? Because, as I said, it started multifaceted, and there were certainly in the beginning, around the turn of the century, from 19th through 20th century, there were some idealists. But it very soon turned into the present-day political Zionism, which I have defined before. We start with historical facts. Around 1900, in nearly all parts of Europe, there was a virulent anti-Semitism. I'm old, but I did not live at that time. But I'm one of the few living people who survived 12 full years of the worst anti-Semitism history has seen so far. So that means I think, and I've written 3 books, and the last book especially about anti-Semitism. I have studied it, I've lived through it, and I've lived through it in a very, very impressive period of my life. Hitler came when I was 9 and I lived in Nazi Germany. So I think I know a bit about it. Whatever, the virulent anti-Semitism of the turn of the century, of the 19th to the 20th century, brought also in France, there was also a wave. It was in Russia, it was in Austria, it was in Germany, it was in England. The whole Balfour Declaration has been done by the very anti-Semitic Lord Balfour, because he didn't want to see the Russian refugees who came from Russia and wanted to live in England. He didn't want them to see them through his walking along the window, his window, so therefore he made this Balfour Declaration. But Theodor de Hartel, we go back, the founder, father of Zionism, was a fully assimilated, enlightened Viennese journalist who spent, during the Dreyfus process, was in Paris to report for a Viennese journal. And I don't know whether you know what the Dreyfus process was. Due to the emancipation, there was a Colonel Dreyfus, Alfred Dreyfus, who was a member of the general staff of the French army. And due to the very fierce anti-Semitism there, somebody forged papers and asserted that he was a spy for the Germans, for the Germans. And eventually it took a man of the stature of Zola to prove that it was all forged, that this famous article, J'accuse, I accuse, and eventually he was rehabilitated. And Herzl, coming back to Herzl, was rightly appalled that all this orgy of anti-Semitism in France was possible out of this country in France, because France was a pioneer country of Jewish emancipation. Now I have done this in a schematic way. So yeah. So here we have it in scheme, how the cursive words and the nationalism should be, I think, we come to it. The recursive words, which we will see, are the elements of Zionism, and they are all bad. First of all, we have the Enlightenment, which brings the French Revolution, which brings Napoleon. And Napoleon does two things which are of importance here. He occupies great parts of Europe, and we will see creates in this way the typical, around the time, blossoming nationalism in Europe. And he introduces the emancipation of the Jews, which brings fear of economic threat. Before the time, anti-Semitism, or anti-Judaism, we should say, was based only or mainly on theological arguments that the Jews refused to see Jesus Christ as the Savior or as the Messiah, and as the Son of God, the personal Son of God. So therefore, before the turn of the century, it was mainly theological, and now very strong economic arguments were used. Yeah. So the occupation, as I said, brought nationalism, and nationalism brought colonialism, and the fear of economic threat made that the anti-Semitism got a new underpinning, which was much more fitted for the time, economic threat. And unfortunately, Mr. Hetzel had a completely wrong idea. He thought that anti-Semitism had to do, by that time it was anti-Semitism, that anti-Semitism came because the Jews had no own country. And as we now know very well, and those of you who know a bit of the post-World War II history, relatively shortly after the Second World War, the existence of a country much more mighty than Israel, is China. And the existence of a country like China has never been able to prevent terrible, very cruel pogroms against Chinese traders in Indonesia. So it is a wrong antidote, and we have to live with it, but that is the thing. But what is important, without anti-Semitism, Zionism is nowhere. And the bad thing is, the bad news is, that the statistics in Europe prove that the anti-Semitic incidents in Europe have risen by a factor of four in number of incidents per time in Europe during the massacre on Gaza. So we have come to the beautiful situation that one of the main causes of present-day anti-Semitism is the criminal behavior and the inhuman behavior and the unlawful behavior of the State of Israel. Okay, next one. I will relatively quickly go over the new sciences, which came also up at the turn of the century. That was the philology, which brought the Indian-Aryan languages and the Semitic languages and the difference between them. And the biology occupied itself very intensively with the differences in human races. But both these two things were wrongly interpreted. The philologists thought, because they had rightly detected nearly all European languages, with the exception of three or four, have Celtic as well as Germanic languages or Romanic languages, Slavic languages, all come from the Indo-Iranian or Indo-Aryan languages. That is the oldest of this group is indeed Indo-Iranian. They were very similar. Sanskrit and Iranian at the time, Aryan was very similar.